The video on the setup of how I'm fly cutting the top part of the molds that I'm going to make. So one of the things about the fly cutter is that it's basically this little carbide tip that flies around, and it can actually take a sliver of the surface of the metal off. And in this way, that arc is fairly large. You can take a fair amount of material in one swipe, and then you can also get a pretty nice finish with it. However, because it's a wide arc, it's imperative that the machine is squared up as good as you can get. I'm going to show you a couple of things. They call that tramming the machine when you're getting it squared up. And so the critical things are basically making sure the column is vertical. The way I do that is I set a machinist square on the table and then run it up to the column, and you better not see any air gaps between the rule and the column, and that'll tell you that the unit is squared vertically and in that axis. And then the other axis is basically kind of left and right here in terms of the column swinging to the counterclockwise or clockwise, and this is a very critical tram measurement as well. I'm going to grab a larger square. I've positioned the table so that I can put a square on it, and then this part of the unit here is what I'm going to square up against. And then the other thing I did was I raised the head up fairly high so that any differences will show up easily. So I've got the a larger square on the table, and then I move this over, and I'm looking for any air gaps. There is that half circle there is why you see air there, but you can see on the top upper and the lower part of that there's no air gap at all. So this is square counterclockwise and clockwise as you're facing the machine. In order to fly cut atop a piece like this, you can't have any fixtures holding the machine or the piece down. And so what I've done is I've created a small CNC drilling program, and then I did use fixtures to hold the piece down while I drilled, and I set the origin in the middle so the machine worked this way and it stayed away from the fixtures. But what I've done is created essentially a recess for a number 1032 cap head screw, and those are I think 3/4 of an inch, because basically I've got this set up on a kind of a sacrifice piece of aluminum down here that's 1/4 inch. And then those are going into T-nuts that are in the table grooves. So this is, I grab a T-nut here, show you what those look like. Alright, so that's a T-nut, and it goes in the groove here, and then number 1032 cap screw can screw into that, and then that's all pulled down to the table. So to get this piece ready for fly cutting, I'll go ahead and square it up, even though that's since we're not doing anything relative to the square on this yet, we're just basically shaving the surface. I'll square this up and then strap it down. Okay, so I've got this squared up, and I've used the cap head screws to lock it down in place. The other thing I did was I used these handy little 3-2-1, 1-2-3 blocks, and that can help you square up the top piece with the bottom as well. So I used the combination of the square and the 1-2-3 block to help me get that completely square. Now the reason that I want to fly cut the top of this, and I'll try to zoom in close enough, you can see that there is some recess, there's definitely material above the top of the screw, and I want that to be the case because I don't want that fly cutter to be hitting the screws. And the reason that I'm going to fly cut this is because this aluminum comes out in essentially bars or long sticks like a 2x4, and I've had my metal company has cut those up for me. You can also use a non-ferrous aluminum cutting circular saw blade to cut those as well. But the reason that I want to fly cut this, which is the thing that's going to put a nice even surface on this, is because this is going to be the working side of the mold that I'm going to use. And these links of aluminum tend to have a little bit of concavity in the middle here, and so they're a little bit higher on the edges. And I want this to be completely flat, because if it's not, then even though it's under a lot of pressure in the mold, there can still be air gaps, and that's what causes flash. So we want to make this as smooth as possible in order to reduce the amount of flash in the mold. So I've set a finished piece up here beside the one that I'm about to fly cut. This is the finished version. It's been fly cut. It's smooth as can be. I've run a little bit of steel wool over it just to smooth anything else out. So it is really, really smooth. And this is basically where the sort of thing that it came from. So the level difference here is because the one we're about to cut is sitting on a little sacrifice piece. So. But you can just start to make out some visual ridges here, but that's just some vagaries from the fly cutter and the finish. But this is just smooth as can be. You cannot feel any ridges in here at all. So I've zeroed or homed the CNC machine to be this upper left-hand corner, but off to the left about 3 or 4 millimeters, because what I want to be able to do is just use some of the manual commands from Linux CNC, and we're going to basically wash across here left and right as we go, and I'm going to do that all by hand. So the machine itself, there's no CNC program that I'm doing. I'm just entering in some commands. But what I'm going to do is basically, since I've set it kind of near the corner, it's up just ever so slightly, and what I'm going to use is the Linux CNC commands to lower that head just slightly until it just starts to pick up an edge there, and then that's the first layer that we're going to take off. Okay, so I've started the CNC spinning, and for fly cutting you don't want a super fast RPM. It does need to be about half of what the max is here, and there are some formulas that people give you. If you were doing steel, the RPM would be even slower. So I've got this set at what I believe is about half the max RPM. Now, what we're going to do is come over to the Linux CNC, and I'm going to manually, so I've set it up on manual, and click the Z axis, and then over here, I'm going to set this on increment, and then I'm going to lower the head by 1/100th of a millimeter at a time. So I'm going to have my hand on the page down, which is going to lower the head, and I'm going to watch over here until the fly cutter starts to strike the aluminum. Now make sure if you're doing this you have your safety glasses on. The chips do can fly, so you may be able to hear the stepper motor come down just a little bit at a time. And right when this hits, you'll see a little arc come out of the corner of that. Okay, now you can just start to hear it tick on the edge. It's a little hard to see that it's actually picking anything up. Okay, but I can tell that it has. We'll go ahead and I'm going to drop this down just a little bit more, take a little heavier cut. Alright, now we're going to come back over to the CNC control program, and I'm going to switch to the MDI commands area. And I've set up a command here that's going to take it from essentially where it's at with an X of about 4.21 millimeters, and it's going to go in the X direction 160 millimeters. And I've got the feed set up. The feed rate is set at 276 millimeters per minute, but then I've got the override backed off here. So what you want to do is start out kind of slow, just in case you've taken a little bit too big of a bite, and then come back. I clicked on the MDI, and I'm just about to execute this command. So I'm going to shift the screen over so you can kind of see it start to take off, and then with my left hand I'm going to hit the enter button, and hopefully the chips fly like they should. So you can kind of hear the fly cutter hitting the aluminum. You can start to see this arc develop where it's actually shaving off the top of the aluminum. There's a little bit of a shape to it as well, because the surface of the aluminum is just not completely uniform. You kind of expect that. This is kind of just getting a feel for the shape of it, because you don't want to start off with a heavy cut and then find out that to stay on that level, the cut has to get even heavier. So we're starting out slow and light, and now I'll come over here and actually speed this up a little bit with the feed control. You can hear it speed up, and now it's kind of zipping by here. I can see little flakes flying. I don't know if it's going to show up in your iPhone video or not. So once this gets across, then what I'm going to do is use the manual CNC to bring the y-axis in the negative direction, so down the piece, and basically bring it back again. So that wasn't a bad depth there. I might take it back down just a little bit more and bring it back on that same path before changing the y-axis. So I took it down about 0.05 of a millimeter, and we're bringing it back on the same x-axis that it went out on. So you can see it's cutting a little bit more. That's a pretty good swing there. It's not a... If it was taking out a perfect amount of material, you would see this line right here be perfectly straight. And I'm very careful when I put my finger down there, because that cutter is swinging around a larger arc than what you see in the spindle bend. You can see how that's really smoothing things out.